Friends don't let friends track their periods.
Get seduced by sociopaths?
Have sex with Elon Musk. Friends don't let friends drink apple cider vinegar.
100%.
Hello and welcome to
Good For You.
Good for you, man. Good for you. Good for you.
For You, a podcast about the things we ghosted, the purchases that haunt us, the best products, services, and industry happenings in the wellness, well-being, and spiritual space. We're going to give you a healthy little dose of fun. We're going to talk about the things that are happening in pop culture, the ones that got away, the things in our cart that are haunting us or ghosting us, our strong opinions
that are loosely held. We like to call this the Grext.
The group text.
The group text in your ear. So come say hello. Join us in the audio Grext, where friends don't let friends get scammed.
Hi, Wallace.
Hi, Michelle. How you doing?
Oh, you know, just living, laughing, loving.
So I received an urgent text about a new drink that we needed to try ASAP, which is a dill pickle seltzer from Trader Joe's that was described as tasting like pumpkin spice, I believe, or pumpkin. I just heard pumpkin spice.
Honestly, I didn't even get all the way through the video because I was like, dill pickle seltzer sounds so weird. We have to try it.
Immediate add to cart. You didn't even need to watch the video.
Truly, but that might have also been my downfall because when I went to Trader Joe's to get it last night, I was looking all over. I was looking in the news section. I was like, it must be one of their new summer drinks. Couldn't find it. I was like, wow, weird. And then I walked over to the alcoholic section and it's an alcoholic seltzer.
Womp womp.
It's a spiked seltzer and it's called the Shell House Dill Pickle Spiked Seltzer Water.
You know, a little pick-me-up at 12 p.m. on a Monday.
You know?
I was at Trader Joe's this morning, New York time, asking all of the people in there, do you have a dill pickle seltzer? They must have been like, ma'am, are you okay?
You having a hard day?
Case of the Mondays. So instead, I got a sparkling ginger and lemon apple cider vinegar beverage. Gross, right?
I just made the most disgusting face because that sounds terrible, but... You know, honestly, like, I don't like pickles. I really don't like dill pickles. So,
whoa. Really?
Yeah. I like other types of pickles, but I don't like dill pickles.
That's fair.
So, this will be an experiment for both of us.
Truly. I also have been noticing that there are a lot of apple cider vinegar beverages, and it feels very, where were you 5 years ago? Missed the boat.
Also, I don't want to drink that.
No.
I don't want it.
I did have a moment of following the medical medium. I mean, who didn't? I don't know.
Honestly, I'm drinking celery juice right now.
Oh,
I'm making it in the morning.
He has some hits. He has some misses for me, but he has some serious hits.
Tons of misses.
Yeah.
Absolutely tons of misses.
But juice, fruit, hit.
Even a broken clock is right twice a day.
There you go. But I will never forget that he was basically like, apple cider vinegar is a scam. And everything that it's promising is false. Like, just don't waste your money. Stop trying to drink it. Why do you think it's going to solve all these problems? Like, he was basically like, this is ridiculous that this has become a trend.
Love that scam deflection.
Oh, yeah.
He was like, look away from my scam into this greater scam, exactly. Which is apple cider vinegar.
Yeah, and I just could never unhear that. And for some reason, I was just like, I think you're right about that. I think it should just stay in salad dressings. But, you know, there's a placebo effect. That could be real.
I used to use apple cider vinegar instead of conditioner in my hair when I was zero waste. And it did make my hair really shiny and really smooth. So.
And soft?
Yeah, pretty soft. But downside is that you smell like vinegar.
Right. I'm just a walking pickle now.
I was single. Anyways, let's try this.
Okay. I'm pouring mine over ice.
ASMR. Oh, nice. I'm going to drink mine with a straw.
Oh.
A glass straw.
Love that. Great experience.
Cheers.
Cheers. Mm. Awful. Oh. Disgusting.
Oh, now this is extremely weird. It does not taste like a dill pickle at all.
Mine tastes like carbonated apple cider vinegar. That's it.
That is my nightmare. I taste the clove, which I think is probably what tastes like kind of pumpkin, I don't know, pumpkin pie-y.
See, I don't know what's wrong with me. I don't like it, but it's in front of me and it's iced, so I'll probably drink it.
Honestly? If you don't like dill pickles, you might like this dill pickle seltzer because it doesn't taste at all like dill pickles. It tastes like clove.
On a scale of 1 to 5 pumpkin spices, whatever that is.
I'd give it a 4. Honestly, I'd give it a 4.
Okay.
It's cool. It's not too sugary. It is, you know, somewhat refreshing. Oh, you know what this kind of reminds me of? It reminds me of like bitters. When you put bitters in soda water because it has similar flavors.
Would you bring it to a barbecue?
100%. Oh. Just for, you know, like kitsch factor alone. But also this is genuinely really good.
4 out of 5 pumpkin spices.
I guess they're iced pumpkin spice lattes, you know?
They're just always trying to get us with a latte.
So if you can find this at your local Trader Joe's, I would recommend it. Also, apparently there's a dupe for the Unseen Sunscreen.
At Trader Joe's?
From Supergoop at Trader Joe's. Yep.
Squeeze me? I thought the Unseen didn't work that well.
Honestly, I'm rethinking everything I know about Supergoop and what I've, all my preconceived ideas about it since I started testing sunscreen, and Supergoop like totally works.
Okay.
And how many medical medium faces would you give your apple cider vinegar drink?
I would give it 0.5. I can't even. How could they package this?
Maybe you should try repurposing it on your hair.
That's not a bad idea.
Think about it.
Just become zero waste over here. Yeah. All right.
I can't wait to taste test with you in real life again.
Is it just me, or does nobody want to riff these days? There is a dearth of repartee, a famine of wit. Keep up, people. We need to keep up. We need to be witty. We need to keep each other on each other's toes. I want stupid puns. I want dad jokes. I want you to say inappropriate things.
Okay. Wow.
We got a lot on our plate today.
We do.
Should we go right into good for who?
Let's do it. We got a spicy, spicy good for who.
We're talking more about vaginas this week.
Vagina, vagina, vagina. If you're not comfortable yet, start practicing now.
There you are. Okay. So I need to first state our knowingness of people and entities in this story. We are going to be talking about Stardust, the period tracking app. And who is it good for? Good for who? Good for you? Good for me? Good for Stardust. However, caveating with the fact that the Holisticism team, we have met the founder of Stardust one time. So, Wallace, are you up to date with the Stardust drama?
I think I have now caught up. You sent me a great TikTok saga that I caught up on. And then I also was just watching some of their updates on their page that the founder made. And I think I am up to date. But for those uninitiated, let's recount.
So Stardust is a period tracking app that was created a couple years ago. We've mentioned it on Holisticism's email newsletter when they first started because it was an app that was synced with the moon. It was super witchy and really fun. It's an alternative to like Flow or Clue or something like that. Most recently, Stardust has really blown up because they publicly stated when it was leaked that Roe v. Wade was potentially at risk, that they would never leak or sell your data so that you would always be protected in terms of like your reproductive rights and stuff like that. So they posted something on June 24th saying, hands off our bodies, hands off our data. And they'd been posting kind of stuff like that ever since the Roe v. Wade leak happened. And when, of course, it was overturned, they doubled down on this marketing effort because it's come out that period tracking apps like Flow are not necessarily going to keep your data private if something happens in the United States, which means that law enforcement could have access to your personal reproductive tracking, could tell that you're pregnant, or let's say you go into a hospital and you're hemorrhaging and you test positive for pregnancy, they could go into your phone or they could check out the apps that you have, subpoena the data and see that you are indeed pregnant and that either resulted in a miscarriage or an abortion, which could send you to jail. Darkest timeline.
I think Flow admitted to selling users' data to Facebook and they actually settled for an undisclosed amount recently.
Yeah, I think that's right. So Flow is on everyone's shit list.
Unfortunately, I used Flow for a very long time.
Me too. Me too, a really long time.
Yeah, I was like, God damn it.
So Stardust has come out, like really taken advantage of what's happening and jumped on the bandwagon, I would say, with Roe v. Wade being overturned and said that they've got end-to-end encryption on this app. You are so protected. No one's going to get access to your data. We're never going to sell your data, blah, blah, blah. And of course, TikTok detectives are like, is that so? Because your privacy agreement says something different, which is basically that you'll willingly hand over our information to law enforcement just if you're asked.
Clearly, I have gripes.
Then Stardust was like, oh, no, 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 no. Sorry, that was just an old privacy update. situation thing. Let us update the language. Okay, great. So they update the language. So it doesn't say that. It says now you'd need a subpoena to get the data. Okay, cool. Marginally better. But then Stardust comes out saying that they've used end-to-end encryption. They're using end-to-end encryption on the app to protect your data so that your information can never be traced back to you. And when you and I were talking about this, Wallace, this is what really got you, may I say, triggered?
Mm-hmm. Yes. It was also that they were saying that they had a encrypted wall.
Yeah, which isn't really a
thing. It's a made-up term, apparently, which I would have believed that had I not, you know, looked into it further.
Right. Well, it's because end-to-end encryption doesn't really make sense for something like an app. No. Like end-to-end encryption makes sense on like WhatsApp, right?
Yeah.
In case you're not a techie person, like you're like me and you're like, oh, I don't really know what that is. End-to-end encryption just basically says that only the recipient of what you're sending is able to read the data or the plain text of what you're sending. If it's intercepted by somebody else, they won't be able to read it. So it's kind of like whoever is the person who's supposed to receive that, mm-hmm. that message has like a cheat code or is able to translate it. But even with end-to-end encryption, the government can still subpoena that information from the end user, which will then be unlocked. So if you're using end-to-end encryption with an app, as opposed to like sending a message to, like, let's say between me and Wallace, you're sending the data to the app. So the app, in this case, Stardust, the data could still be subpoenaed, and it doesn't really matter that it's got end-to-end encryption.
No, and I think this is an example of people trying to capitalize on, unfortunately, global issues in order to serve their own bottom line.
Totally. It got Stardust, I mean, just by kind of putting this stuff out when they first started, with their first response to the overturn of Roe v. Wade, they were the number one downloaded app in the App Store for like a couple days in a row. So definitely, the marketing definitely worked.
The pile of lies.
You sit on a throne of lies.
Especially the irony of capitalizing on specifically this issue when you're running an app that the goal is to essentially empower people who have periods with more information and have them feel safe, et cetera. The irony is just too great.
It really is. Again, once again, the darkest timeline. Yeah. Something like that. But do you think that it was, I mean, I have a theory, but do you think that this was malicious intent from the start?
No. Well, I tend towards a bias of people don't consciously have malicious intent. I think they can inadvertently.
But people are inherently evil.
Yeah, I think people are selfish for sure.
I was joking.
I do.
You're like, no. Yeah, I'm there. They're horrible.
Remember, people are lost. We were talking about sociopaths the other day.
Yeah, but only 1 in 25 people is a sociopath.
Yeah, it happens to be like a ton of founders of tech companies that we idolize.
I mean, yep, put a pin in that.
That's G's J. And what that means is that's God's job. And I'm not religious even a little bit, but basically it's like you got to relinquish it up to the universe. You know what I'm saying? Like, G's J, just say it. It's so fun. G's J, come on.
I think that this is a combination of bad PR, ignorance, and just poor decision making kind of all converging at once. And, you know, trying to, I think, jump on an opportunity to grow their user base. And it was a choice decision and a poor one at that.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, the Mark Zuckerberg quote that startup founders love to regurgitate is move fast and break things. And I think this is a really good example of moving fast and breaking a ton of shit. Yeah. It's so common in the startup world to effectively lie about where you are and to just kind of hope that by the time people fact check you, you'll have bridged the gap between the lie and reality. Yeah. I remember when I was raising money for Holisticism, so many white male founders told me, oh, just lie about your numbers.
Yeah, just fudge them just a little.
Not even just a little, like project where you're going to be in 6 months, because by the time people check, you'll already be there. It's like, I'm not going to do that. I do not have that confidence. I have an anxiety disorder. I could not lie about my numbers. But I think it's really common in Stardust is a tech startup. So they've raised money and it's very common in that world to kind of say one thing but whilst you're scrambling on the back end to basically create the product or the system that you said you're going to launch in 2 days or you said you've already launched and then just hope that by the time people check that you have figured it out. And I don't think that they exactly figured it out in time. I don't think that they meant to like do something horrible. I don't think that they meant to like they're intending to sell data to the government to like
no.
I don't know, send people who get abortions to jail. But I do think that it's in poor taste to jump on the bandwagon and market in this way during this like really horrifying time. And I think they're going to lose a lot of customers and a lot of trust. And I don't really know if they can get it back, to be honest with you.
Well, also, I think what's complicated about all of this with taking funding is I'm assuming they're not profitable and they don't have exact plans for that. And I'm pretty sure the founder shared that in one of her most updated TikToks. And it's kind of like, you know, maybe we'll add features or we'll have to sell ads or something like that. And she kind of mentions it casually, but it's like, well, yeah, prior to you needing to return, you know, that investment times 10, the goal is to grow the user base as much as possible to head in that direction so that whenever you decide to figure out a monetization strategy, you have that user base there. And I don't know, maybe at the same time, it's grown awareness for the app for a lot of people who didn't know about it. Because I really liked it at the beginning when I was using it. And I was just like, oh, I'm excited for more features to come out. And I only stopped using it because there just wasn't a lot of features for what I wanted.
I stopped using it because I had to make more space on my phone. And I track my period on Notion. I think, honestly, if you're using a period tracker at this moment in time, maybe don't. Maybe don't use an app, you know?
Well, that's the other thing that I feel like came up overall is, for anyone being prosecuted right now or held accountable for assisting or getting an abortion in states where it's become illegal, like in cases past, the things that have been used against people are text messages, Google searches, and overall surf history.
Right.
So maybe the apps will help in these cases, but we're being tracked on so many different accounts that it doesn't really matter. Like you really have to go out of your way to not have any of this tracked.
Yeah. You guys, come on. We know the NSA has already tapped our phones.
Yeah.
They're listening. They're watching. We're boring. But I wonder, yeah, how many of these cases there are going to be people that get prosecuted and like their cell phone data gets pulled up.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
Yeah. And the thing that I think has also happened in the past is more geofencing around specific areas like Planned Parenthood. So it's like if you enter that area of a Planned Parenthood, you can be tracked and that data can be sold very easily. And if you think about any app you have on your phone that tracks your location, including Google Maps, Apple, you know, says that they won't sell it. But there's just so many other ways that we should be more conscious of how our data and information is being shared.
Not to freak everyone out, but.
No, but like if that's the worry.
Yeah. Do you think people are overreacting? That's kind of how I was like, yeah, no, they definitely shouldn't be lying. That's bullshit. But I'm also like, man, you really think your period tracker is going to be the thing that tips the police off? Like there's so much other shit that you should be worried about, to your point.
Yeah, I think that the freak out about period apps is just the kind of scapegoat for what's actually happening, or it's more of the dark omen of it's signaling the darkest timeline.
Right. And that like everything is, it's all inescapable. Like no matter where you turn, nothing is safe. Not even your cute little witchy period tracker. Like it's all out to get you.
It feels so absurd that you're like, aha, Handmaid's Tale is alive and well. In certain states, like, you know, we're both lucky to be in a state that's not a top concern. But I always think about how much time in the day men like don't have to think about this stuff. Like you have so much brain space.
Oh my God, I think about this all the time, but like for so many other things, not just like, you know, our rights being taken away. But I'm like, you don't have to think about like looking good.
Oh,
in order for like people to take you seriously.
No.
Or not aging.
Yeah.
You know,
or just being acknowledged in certain rooms, period.
Yes.
Okay. If guys were to have a version of a period app tracking something, what do you think it would be?
Maybe height.
Like what?
Measuring themselves every day. Just like, okay, quarter of a centimeter today. I'm looking good. I'm feeling fucking fine. You know?
But like biologically, what would they be tracking?
It's sleep, right?
Or that's like why they're testosterone levels?
Totally. Yeah. Like apparently many men, especially biohacking men, are extremely worried about their testosterone levels because they have been depleting significantly.
Because they're not, what, out hunting?
Because women have rights now, so their testosterone is going down. Gotta change that. Yeah. No, I'm not. I think it's an environmental thing. You know,
all the plastics.
With all the plastics and microplastics and your semen and, I don't know, smog.
The nurdles. I always think about the nurdles. No. If you know, you know. I hope you don't, but you should also.
But do a Google if you want to be horrified. Yeah. If this hasn't scared you enough, if you'd like to descend deeper, please, by all means, Google.
What is a nurdle?
I'm extremely confused.
You're confused. I'm fucking confused, bro.
So who's this good for? Is it good for Stardust? Is it good for the government? Is it good for people who use period trackers?
I think the discussion is great in terms of just highlighting and remembering that all of our rights are not equal state to state, and that we should be thinking about these things and helping other people where we can, because what's happening right now is laws are being passed to protect doctors. But ultimately, once doctors are protected from giving people assistance out of state, the people left are the women who are pregnant, who are the ones who are going to be prosecuted for a range of like miscarriages being seen as abortions. And there's just a lot of kind of scary stuff coming down the pipelines for a lot of these states. So I think what's important is to keep the discussion alive, even though I don't think it's really about the period apps. I think it's a good gateway to be cognizant of really where this is going and how many rights will be taken away from women and who will be in danger in a lot of these states going forward.
Yeah, women and people who can give birth. I think we all were like, no, it'll never get that bad. And then it's like, oh, it is kind of that bad. So it is a good reminder, albeit like extremely depressing. So. Maybe in a way this is good for us. Are we bright? Are we trying to like bright side the worst possible news in the world?
Yeah, I'm like, I don't know. What is the bright side?
Toxic positivity. Come on. We gotta find something to live for.
Yeah, seriously. What do you think?
I mean, for me, after working in startups for so long, I kind of look at it as this is just an extension of kind of the problems in the tech sector and in expecting companies to grow at an exponential rate when there's only a few people on a team, and also expecting companies to respond rapidly to the government, like expecting private companies, which is kind of like the capitalism, small government thing, like companies will take care of us, private sector will take care of us. And I think this brings into question the validity of that, and also makes us just, as I think we are on Good For You, a little bit more skeptical of anyone who runs a business. Like, what is the intent here? Why is this person or this company doing this thing? Why are they boosting their marketing in this specific way or their language in this way? And, you know, not that we need to give everyone the side eye, but I think it's good to be a conscientious consumer.
Like, I don't wish any ill will towards Stardust. I really hope that, you know, this is a great learning point for them, and this means that they can figure out, you know, how to release these products and these different features in a better way in the future. But I hope they don't go away. I like that.
I am rooting for them to turn this around, to get on the straight and narrow, to do their thing, and for this to just be a blip on their timeline and all of our timelines, hopefully.
I was rooting for you. We were all rooting for you. How dare you?
Well, moving on to, you know, just another scam of the week. Our sexy, unique scam sighting.
Sexy, sexy, sexy.
You brought to my attention.
Yeah, you know me and my Instagram ads. They're rife with sexy, unique scams.
I know we read our targeted ad categories, but you're just, I feel, on the top list for new D2C experimental products. And I'm like, it's kind of cool.
Honestly, I feel like I'm an elite sort of group
of testers.
Yeah. I don't know how I got there. I'm like walking in the room, looking around. I'm like, I don't know any of you, but I'm just honored to be here, yeah. Truly. And the startup that came across my feed was called Cabinet Health. And I had never heard of them before this, although I felt like I'd seen them before. I hadn't. There's just a bunch of companies that are kind of doing this, a similar thing or in the same sort of space, which is effectively just D2C medications, like over-the-counter medications that you could get at Rite Aid or CVS. And they're making them beautiful in millennial and Gen Z friendly packaging. But the thing that caught my eye was in their Instagram bio, they said that they're plastic negative. Wallace, what do you think plastic negative means?
I'm trying to unpack it without knowing what the scam is in that languaging. I think plastic negative is that they only support positive plastic talk. I don't know. I just don't trust it immediately.
They've done studies, you know. 60% of the time, it works every time.
That doesn't make sense.
We talked about scientism last week, and we've definitely talked about greenwashing on the podcast and sustainability washing. To me, I was like, red flag, because that's sustainability washing. What the fuck even is that? That is a fake sort of marketing piece of terminology. Yeah. And when you just dig an inch below the surface, you'll see that their products are just made in glass.
Are they all glass, even the top?
No, I think the top is not glass.
What's that made of?
I'm pretty sure the top is plastic.
Nurdles. Recycled nurdles.
So I definitely did a Google on this guy, on this company. But what are your first impressions, Wallace, as you're like looking at it and sort of perusing on IG?
Well, I wanted to just try and buy. Like, I want to see how much are these things.
Good question.
It was not giving me an easy shop experience from Instagram.
Oh yeah. So these are kind of like square stacking glass bundles is what they're called. They're called bundles. And they have different sets and they're over-the-counter meds. So there's like an essential bundle that's $52 and $52.70 for four different products: a pain reliever and fever reducer, natural sleep aid, daytime severe cold and flu, and then allergy.
My first impression is it looks like it could be slightly convenient for traveling because I'm biased right now and I'm just thinking about travel convenience. And then my second opinion is that these are wildly overpriced. And unless they're using some superior, like they're not, they're definitely fucking white labeling Advil. It's all just like ibuprofen.
Right. All that stuff is out on the market. It's like, that's why CVS can make the same version of Advil, but call it CVS, not Advil. It's the exact same formulation. It's just cheaper and doesn't have as nice of branding. It's not a name brand. All this stuff is like public information. But they've also said that their stuff is gluten-free, just as a heads up.
That's like calling Advil nut-free, isn't it?
I would think so. But I mean, first I rolled my eyes and I was like, I guess if you have celiac, you really do have to be really careful.
What if you have a peanut allergy? There could be cross-contamination. Peanuts seem to be processed anywhere and everywhere.
That is fair. You know what? I didn't think of that. And that is my bad. I'm calling myself in here. You're absolutely right. So they've got a bunch of different products right now. This company started a couple years ago, I think around the beginning of the pandemic. And I was I actually said, holy shit, out loud, because they raised $6.6 million for their seed round, which is an insane amount of money.
Yeah.
That like basically means that they think they're going to be a unicorn. They think they're worth $1 billion. If you raise that much as your seed round. Because if you raise that much, if you raise like a 10 million Series A, you're basically saying that's the valuation of your company. So I was like, whoa, you guys really think that with this like kind of cute Tylenol, you're going to be doing that? All right. And then I double clicked, looked a little deeper. They also love to flaunt the fact that they're a certified B Corp. And do you know what that means, Wallace?
I know that everyone who's a B Corp is very proud of it.
Because it's pretty hard to get, especially if you're a bigger company. However, this company, it seems like, has under 20 employees and they just started. So I'm not saying it's easy, but it's probably easier for a company like this to become a certified B Corp than, say, Patagonia, which is another certified B Corp. It just basically means that an outside corporation measures their environmental and social impact to see how they can continue to improve. And if they don't measure up, then they get their B Corp certification sort of pulled.
Yeah.
You for that really important addition.
No, I'm sorry. I was maybe reading something on their website about what do you mean when you say your package is fully compostable. And I was distracted by the jargon. I want to know who these PR firms are. This says cabinet pouches are made out of 100% earth digestible materials. And then in brackets, compostable materials, in case you misinterpreted the digestible component. Specifically, the pouches are actually made out of wood, cellulose, and biomaterials. I love these descriptors. Biomaterials, in case you weren't sure what biomaterials are. It could be natural or synthetic, alive or lifeless, and usually made of multiple components.
Okay, so it's anything. So it's any kind of material.
I love this. And then the pouch is compostable in city compost piles. All right. And is in the process of being BPI certified.
I'm pretty sure anything other than styrofoam is compostable eventually, unfortunately. let's give them that. And let's say that, yes, if you add it to a compost pile after a couple of months, this thing will disappear. I don't know. I am not so suspicious. I think this isn't a bad idea to have these.
No.
They're calling themselves the Sustainable Healthcare Co. I think it's a bit like extreme to call yourself sustainable healthcare company when you make glass bottles with plastic tops. I don't know. Just call yourself what you are, which is a D2C company that's making it cheaper to buy Advil, although you're not actually making it cheaper to buy Advil. You're making it prettier, more aesthetic, a medicine cabinet.
And not only are the individual products more expensive, but you also have to subscribe. So it's doubly more expensive. So you're paying for convenience and design.
Right. And you're getting sent the refill, right, every time you use it. And we know that with refillable products, we've talked about this before, you have to use the refill, I think it's like close to 50 times in order to offset to make the like sort of refillable element of that beauty product or that skincare product or whatever product like this actually work, like to really see the benefit of using something that's reusable.
And also the likelihood of everybody actually using the product that much. It's like, you're not going through that much stomach and flu medicine, I would hope.
If you are, go to the doctor. Like, what's going on?
I just love the lingo they have on here too.
I mean, you guys need to up the pay on your copywriter or whoever, your marketing specialist, whoever's doing this, because it is quite a tangled web to unweave. And honestly, it's pretty enough that if I wasn't a super like skeptical person, I'd be like, these are cute. I'll totally have these in my house. Whatever.
Well, you know? It is the convenience factor, which I feel like we've talked about too, when you're like, oh, I'm just going to go to Duane Reade or Walgreens or whatever. And then you're like, great, they don't have anything in stock.
Right. But then you can get it from Amazon next day.
Right. So I don't know. I mean, they do want you to know on the FAQ page that all the caps are child resistant.
They should
not be. Child proof. Child resistant. Oh.
They actually repel the chill. I'm just picturing like a child like reaching out and it just like blows backwards.
There's an invisible repellent shield.
I want one of those. How do I get a child repellent shield?
Yeah. Stay away. It's actually called, what are those high-pitched noise things that they play where they don't want like teenagers to loiter? They fucking work.
Yes, yes, yes. That's like a psyops situation.
Yeah.
That's like the Havana syndrome, you know?
I think it's illegal in most places, hopefully.
Yeah, I think that could drive someone crazy. But you have to admire like the creativity there.
Oh, yes. Very creative copywriting. You know, I could be duped into buying this out of convenience, but then I'm over-indexed on subscription services, so I'm just annoyed by them generally.
I feel like the only one of these I would really probably use is pain relief.
Yeah.
I don't really take a lot of this other stuff. And
maybe this would be good for like a fancy daycare. I don't know. Except for they're child resistant. Oh. So yeah. I don't know. Like where is this meant to be?
Or maybe like an Airbnb, except you're not really supposed to have
droga.
Yeah. You're not supposed to give drugs to people.
So I'm not really sure like who uses this.
Yeah. For the $6.6 million that they raised a couple years ago, they have a pretty small following on social, which doesn't necessarily mean anything. But I also just pulled up their stats on their website and there is not enough data to give traffic. So I would imagine that means that their traffic's less than 20,000 people per month.
I'm just dying to follow a D2C drug company on all the socials.
I mean, hey, if anyone could turn it around, it could be you, Walla.
They should just hire Radio Shack's content. Whoever's running the Twitter at Radio Shack, hats off to you.
I mean, I think they're on drugs, yeah. But like they're crushing it.
They're perfect for
like,
the internet.
Keep on keeping on, yeah. Man. It's great. So what do you think? Is this a sexy, unique scam or do we stan?
I sniff a pungent scam. Personally. It's close. It could be okay, but it doesn't do it for me. How about you?
Yeah, I agree. I feel like scam, kind of similar with Stardust. I feel like they maybe like doubled down on one element of the brand when other things weren't working. And I don't know if like leaning into sustainability when you're not necessarily the most sustainable company is the way to go. But, you know, I could be wrong. We'd love to hear from you, dear listener. What do you think of Cabinet Health? Would you buy it? Do you not really care? Does the sustainable thing matter to you? Or are you just like, I just want a really cute medicine cabinet that's Instagrammable? Let us know.
Do tell.
Are we at the dawn of the renaissance of the new ad age?
Could be, because guess what? Big ads are coming back to TV. Whether you want it or not, you can pay more or you can deal with ads now on HBO, Netflix, everywhere.
Yeah, we've really regressed to the 1950s in almost every element of the world, it feels like, at this time, politically.
We're just in a time machine.
It's just like Don Draper, make him great again, you know?
Ugh, oh, God. No, now we just have like Elon Musk. That's the new idol.
Did you hear that he has twins? Does twins with this like random lady?
Yeah. Also, epic egomaniac, sociopath behavior. He has like 9 children.
Yes. He thinks he's personally responsible for repopulating the world. He thinks that underpopulation is the problem, which I'm sorry. No.
I'll never forget the theory of population check that, you know, the earth every once in a while is going to be like, you know what, motherfuckers? Climate change. You know what? You know what?
Clean house.
Yeah. I believe that the earth is smarter than all of us.
I think so. I think she is. How do people still look up to Elon Musk?
Typical boy boss behavior.
Typical.
You know, just so textbook. He couldn't get more textbook if he wanted to.
People were saying he's going to pull out of the Twitter deal, but he couldn't pull out of his executive, and hence the twins.
Boys be boys. Anyways, we are here to finish off today with a last-minute packing haunted cart.
Get in, loser. We're going shopping.
This is going to be a reveal in real time. I got the new alchemy deck.
Oh.
But I got them for all of us.
Oh, my God. Fun. Wait, this is great because I have been like, I need a new deck. I need a new deck.
You're like, oh, what deck am I going to bring? And you were like, I don't know if I have one. So I was like, okay, I'll bring, that'll be cool. I'll bring those. So Then Ethan was like, don't bring those. They're not going to want to lug them around Europe. And I was like, yes, they will.
Yes.
Yes, they will. You don't know them like I know them.
I'm spending 4 days alone in Florence and I plan to have seances every night.
That's a perfect place to have a seance, by the way.
I thought so. I was like, where am I going to be? I'm going to go to Florence.
I love that. So that's my sort of last minute packing. Also, I did do a last minute bra from Skims delivery. However, I did not do same day shipping because they don't do it in where I live in Mount Washington. So
you not a West Hollywood bitch.
I'm not. But I needed a black bra. And I don't have one that doesn't have underwire, and I'm just not into underwire anymore. And it's like, but I need this for my look. So yeah. I got a Skims bra and I'm pretty excited about it.
Have you laid out like all your outfits? Like, are you doing that kind of packing?
I told you, they're on my bed. One thing I like about staying in an Airbnb is that you can do laundry.
Yes. So true. That is a constant issue I have. I sweat a lot. I really wear my clothes. You know, when people are like, oh, yeah, I don't wash like pants very much or whatever. I'm like, how throughout the day I get stains. I'm like sweating. I don't know.
Honestly, I'm packing 2 white shirts and I'm like, these are both going to be ruined by the end. I just know it. I'm just tempting fate.
Yeah.
Also, the other thing that I did is I laminated my eyebrows today.
Oh, that kit. Oh, how is it?
Great. I had done it before. I tried it a couple weeks ago, probably 4 weeks ago.
How long does it take?
It takes like 16 minutes in total.
What?
Yeah.
Why are they making me wait an hour at salons?
I don't know. They shouldn't, because it's really easy to do. And I redid it because I felt like it had fallen out, you know, like it had been long enough. And now my brows are, they're stuck on my face. They're all fluffy. It's great.
They're stuck on my face. They will not bow down.
What's your last minute packing situation?
I'm really trying to not do last minute buy a bunch of stuff. I'm trying to be very intentional about the pieces. And I'm really missing, honestly, just some white and black tanks right now. Those are the main things I'm looking for to layer with a bunch of different things and also be braless. That's such a goal. In heat, fewer layers there, the better.
It's true. What about unsubscribing from shirts altogether and going with a crop top? Is that something that you would potentially do? Sort of like a bra top?
Yes. I'm just looking for ones that I don't have to wear a bra with. TBH, I haven't done a lot of looking. So
I'm thinking about looking. Wait, where are you going to go? Because you're in New York and there's more stuff I feel like to like shop around in.
I'm also in Soho. So there's a lot of temptations.
That's true.
Honestly, I'm betting on Aerie as maybe having.
So smart.
I'm also contemplating, I've gotten onto this algorithm, actually, thanks to my mom. on Instagram of intentional wardrobe creation, like kind of thinking about the capsule wardrobe, but also how to create an intentional wardrobe over time and buying pieces that last longer and how to do it strategically. And one of the creators that I follow, which we will link in the show notes, her name on IG is Christina.Miches, Miches. I don't know. She is doing a low buy July.
Cool.
I will admit I can't do a low buy July. There are too many things that I need to get.
It will be a high buy.
It will be a high buy July, a low.
Well, what's considered low buy? Is it like under 10 things?
You get to determine this. But what I like is that she sets it out as a challenge and she has like her parameters and gives you suggestions. And I just like her philosophy. I'm like, we have different aesthetics and style and taste, but this low buy July got me thinking that I'll probably do that in August. And I like the idea because it's all about intentionally shopping, being mindful. You can tell it's like she loves style. She loves to consume and, you know, but she's trying to be minimal and intentional about it. And I was like, I vibe with your whole kind of angle here. So she created rules for her low buy July where she's like, I can replace skincare items. I can get a haircut. And if this one shirt that I've wanted for 3 months comes in stock, like I'll buy it, but otherwise I'm not going to buy anything.
Wow.
And it's just kind of cool because it's like not being so extreme. Yeah. It's picking, you know, very intentionally if you're going to purchase what it's going to be. And then also figuring out, okay, what's my intention of buying less this month and feeling it through. So I'm thinking like, that's going to be me in August for multiple reasons. And it was just kind of a nice reminder of you don't actually need more than 3 pairs of shoes on your trip. Like you might think you do, but you definitely don't, which I don't consciously, but then I'm always like trying to fit other things.
You're like, but I need these platforms that I've never worn and I probably am never going to wear, but I might want to wear them on the cobblestone streets of Rome.
Exactly. And they fit in the suitcase. Yeah. So I'm kind of into this not buying is what is haunting my cart and I'm into it.
I like that.
It definitely had me slow down when thinking about getting last minute stuff for this trip.
Yeah. I hate buying last minute things because I feel like whenever I do, I'm just being so wasteful, you know?
And it doesn't usually work out. Sometimes it's stuff where you're like, sweet. And then other times you're like, oh, I just wasted money doing that.
And the final one's pretty simple. It's a replacement for goodbye. I just feel like everyone needs to go, ciao, mama. Instead of saying goodbye, it'd just be a much more spicy life we'd all be living.
So what should we give away this week?
I'm like, low by July. We're not gonna give away anything.
Yeah, you get nothing.
Let's give the alchemy deck away.
Yeah.
So one lucky winner this month will win the alchemy deck from the Wild Unknown, Kim Kranz. We also are huge fans of the archetypes deck here at Holisticism. And this one's really cool. It's like a hexagram shaped deck. It's gorgeous. So we're going to send that to one lucky winner.
All you got to do is give us a 5-star review on Apple Podcasts. Let us know what you think of the pod. And it very high probability of winning.
Extremely high.
It's a fun deck. It's a good party trick. Even if you're not like super duper into decks, it's beautiful. It's fun to explore at a social gathering. Whip it out.
Definitely. You don't have to like know tarot and or oracle decks or even intuitive stuff to like get these decks. We gave the archetypes deck to everyone in our wedding party who gave blessings at our wedding. And the boys tell us that they like them even more than the girls do. Like that it's their favorite deck. So boys, feel free to review us. And we have to announce our winner of last week's giveaway of the
Startup Kit.
Hashtag blessed.
Okay, pick a number between 1 and 5.
3.
The winner is Merwin. Cool name, honestly. I don't know if I'm saying it right. M-I-R-W-I-E-N. Merwin?
Merween, perhaps.
I don't know, but maybe. Either way, we love you. Thank you for writing in. Merwin said, the one thing that I love about this podcast is how relatable it is. I'm always laughing out loud, nodding my head enthusiastically in agreement. For this episode is the mysterious foot growth. I have to start buying a different shoe size in my mid-30s. I felt like my whole life had been a lie up until that point.
But I finally accepted that my toes needed to spread out and take up more space. I blame it on the Birks, but I'm not mad about it. Also, you're not alone, Wallace. I don't mind the consensual TSA pat-down. In fact, you're welcome, officer. Wow.
Hell yeah.
Honestly, great review.
Wait, you want to come to pod, Merwin? I like your style.
And thank you to Isabella Rose, Kimmy Tex, and JoJo2591 for your awesome reviews. We so appreciate it. Thank you.
And AUSU00.
Oh, yes. And yes, AUSU00. Thank you. Thank you. Y'all are the best.
Bye.
Good For You is produced by yours truly, Wallace Miller Blanchard. Our theme song is by Parallel Dance Ensemble, and our wonderful editing is done by Softer Sound Studios, who you can find more information about at the link in our show notes.